All right, welcome to Lunch with Lincoln, everyone. I am Tara Settmeyer, in for Reed Galen today, and my good friend, Dr. Errol Southers, is joining us. We're going to talk a little bit about January 6th, this Justice for January 6th ridiculous rally tomorrow here in D.C., and some of what's happening with this rise in extremism that's still going on, despite what some may try to make you believe. It is still a thing, and it's extremely alarming, which is why we wanted to talk about it. And plus, you know, I'm here in the Washington, D.C. area, and I have a particular interest in this, as does Dr. Southers. And who is he? Well, for those who are regular watchers of The Breakdown and listen to some of the radio shows I've hosted recently, Dr. Southers is a friend of mine and of the Lincoln Project, and he is a very smart guy, very experienced, and a resident badass. But I will give him a more formal introduction. He is the professor of practice in national and homeland security, director of the Safe Communities Institute at USC. He's the director of the Homegrown Violent Extremism Studies there at the USC Price School of Public Policy. He's also a former FBI agent. He was also part of the SWAT team at the FBI. He was also a gang investigator with the Santa Monica Police Department, and he was the Assistant Chief of Homeland Security and Intelligence at the LA Police Department, LA Airport Police Department. So he knows a thing or two about security, about extremism, and about what we're dealing with as a country right now. Dr. Southers, always a pleasure.
Tara, thank you for your very gracious introduction.
always. You deserve it. So, let's talk a little bit about this rally tomorrow. There are aspects of this that feel like it's a collective eye roll where we're all like, again with these people. But then there's also the other side of it where it's clear that the law enforcement entities involved, from Capitol Police all the way to National Guard, everyone is taking this a lot more seriously. It looks like they've learned some lessons from the disaster of January 6th and the intelligence failures there. Of January 6th, and they're taking new steps, and it looks like it may be not necessary, but what do you think? What are some of the biggest lessons we think that the law enforcement entities here have learned from the failures of January 6th?
Well, Tara, thank you. That's a great question. And let's look at what this Justice for J6 rally and what it really is. You know, it's a right-wing extremist rally to support people that participated in a violent effort to thwart the government process or certifying the president's election at the behest of the former president. I know it's the Justice for J6 rally. I'll call it the insurrection reunion.
Yes.
And I think that obviously, due to all of the quote unquote missteps that happened last time, intelligence and open source information is taking very, very seriously now. You know, the fence went back up. Also, facial recognition cameras have been installed. So for those people that participate tomorrow, they won't have to worry about Facebook and Twitter posting themselves. We'll have the images. And since they don't believe in COVID, they won't be masked, and that'll make it even easier for subsequent investigations. So I'm delighted that they are taking this seriously. I don't think you can be overprepared. And so we'll see what happens. I'm also disturbed by the fact that now that there's some talk about another rally next weekend in Georgia with the former president. And so my bigger concern is not so much with tomorrow, but the fact that this moving goalpost will have to cause law enforcement to have to respond to these, if you will, protests and demonstrations routinely for the next 3.5 years.
You know, I'm glad that you brought that up about what's happening next week and how this is, you know, I think people often look at what's happening in DC and the national issues, and they forget about what's going on in our state and local governments here. I mean, what we have seen since Trump has left office, with school board meetings getting out of control, threats against local officials and governors, or even just school board members, for goodness sakes, over the masking issue and vaccines, this is all part of a larger, what I think is a very concerning uprising in this country that is being fomented and curated by not only the president, the former president of the United States, but of members of Congress, elected officials like Madison Cawthorn or Marjorie Taylor Greene or Paul Gosar, some of these people who are talking, using language like, you know, if our elections are still, you know, continue to be stolen, then you're going to see bloodshed, or this is the revolution, and really, really inflammatory language here. And the idea that there are a bunch of people who are under the guise of, I don't know, Republicans now, because the Republican Party really hasn't spoken out against this. They're, you know, their silence is complicity. This idea that they are, this is a protest or a rally for people who were insurrectionists who tried to overturn an election and stop a constitutional process, it boggles the mind. But this seems to almost have been mainstreamed, because now you've got a president's going to do a rally next week in Georgia, basically spouting the same nonsense.
You're absolutely correct. I mean, if we look at the polls, there was a survey in April that says 70% of the Republicans still believe that Biden was not the duly elected president. And as of last month, it increased to 78%.
That's crazy.
But I want to go back to what you said in the beginning about other states. That is something that law enforcement is also taking quite seriously. This is not just about the United States Capitol. And as you know, there's now protective measures in place around the United States Supreme Court in Washington. But this is all 50 states and all 50 state capitals, which I'm assuming are responding to the possibility that they too could have protests, quote unquote, at their respective locations for people who can't get to Washington. And so, as you mentioned, the fact that people like Cawthorn are saying if our election is stolen again, there'll be a civil war. You know, COVID exacerbated this by the fact that when we had stay-at-home orders, you had all of these extremist movements, some based on race, some based on religion, some based on issue orientation, all under this umbrella of anti-government overreach, or I should say anti-government extremism based on government overreach. And so they all have a common enemy now in the United States government, which is extremely ironic that you have elected officials that are pushing back against the government, which is in fact them.
You know, there are, I just think that so many aspects of this, the idea that we have a large group of people in this country that seemingly have no respect for the institutions that are so important to the foundation of keeping our democracy intact. Like, even, you know, now the Supreme Court is a target, where that was something that was revered, and there's, you know, the conservatives got what they wanted. They look at the majority they have on the Supreme Court. Even that's not good enough, because if they don't do everything that you want them to do, then they become the enemy now. It's a zero-sum game for these people. And I worry that the Democrats don't quite get this yet going into the election next year, but that's a different conversation. We have a viewer question where someone is asking, what is it going to stop? What is it going to take to stop this rise in extremism? And, you know, do you think that this is something that we may not be able to stop? That's from Kintia. She asks that on YouTube.
That's a great question. It's almost, I hate to say this, this wave is starting to turn into a tsunami with regards to the fact that people now do not accept outcomes. We just endured a recall here in California. There are these ridiculous audits that are going on across the country, despite the previous administration's government authorities and people who are responsible for elections verifying that it was the most secure election in our country's history. So now if you have an election and it doesn't turn out the way you want, we'll have an audit, we'll have a recall. And we've got a society now that's decided that if the outcome isn't the way I want it to be, it's not real. And right. So that's particularly disturbing. So to answer her question, I'll just say, this is going to require constant pushback on misinformation, constant pushback on disinformation, and if you will, building a more resilient virtual society out there for people who get the majority of their information now, not from mainstream media, but from social media. And that's going to take a lot of work and consistency.
Now, speaking of that, the event tomorrow, you mentioned some of the security enhancements and things that are in place this time that are very different from last time. I've read some of the reports that are saying that intelligence officials think that this is going to be a bust, that it's not going to be what we saw, thank God, back in January, and that some of these people think that it's a false flag event. Some of the groups that we talk about, the Proud Boys, Oath Keepers, some of the more violent extremists, and they're telling their people not to go because they say, look, they're going to don't wear any insignia, don't wear any paraphernalia that's pro-Trump or anything, and you know, they're going to have informants there. They're just trying to, you know, find out who these people are. Do you think that these groups are also using social media and some of these tools to adapt and be more savvy themselves? Because they live on social media. This is part of what allows them to kind of metastasize their ilk. Do you think that they're adjusting too, or who's ahead of whom here?
Well, Tara, they are adjusting. What's interesting is some weeks ago, the Proud Boys had told their followers, let's not go, for the reasons you just mentioned. However, they were energized by President Biden's recent speech on COVID mandates, right, and COVID restrictions. So now they're energized again. However, with all due respect to how serious this is going to be and who's going to show up tomorrow, we had a threat yesterday, and I'm not quite sure how actionable it was, that today there was going to be an attempt to take a member of Congress hostage, which, of course, they're responding to. The former president yesterday decided to leverage this effort, but was very, very careful in his remarks about what they should do this weekend, who should show up, never really mentioning the rally by name.
Right.
I think he's learned a lesson or two also about the fact of how complicit he can be in emboldening folks going forward. So with regards to it being a false flag, we'll have to see what happens. I do think that they understand they're going to be under the microscope tomorrow. And let's hope that for all these folks who claim to back the blue, that they at least take the advice of some members of Congress who have said, respect the men and women of law enforcement that are out there protecting your First Amendment right. Respect them for what they have to do in terms of their jobs.
Errol, you know, I am so sick of any Republican ever saying back the blue anymore, or about, you know, law and order. It makes my skin crawl because they are such freaking hypocrites after what happened. The rally tomorrow is actually about supporting people who assaulted police officers brutally,
right.
You know, like, so I am like, every time I hear people say that, you know, not you, it triggered me because this is something that, you know, Republicans constantly try to, you know, hide behind their patriotism, the Constitution, and, you know, protecting law enforcement and military, when they're all just malleable props in their political craven acts we should call them out on it every single time. Every time,
agree.
Like, Democrats can wrestle away the attacks on them politically about, you know, abolish the police and defund the police and all of this stuff, which almost cost them, you know, the election last time. They could take that away by throwing it right back onto Republicans and show videos and, you know, the quotes and the court transcripts of these people and what they did to our law enforcement. And
exactly.
This is who Republicans are either not saying mum about because they're too scared to, or who are actively supporting it. It's absolute insanity. So that's my little soapbox on that. You brought up Donald Trump, and for those who haven't heard his statement, because he's still not on social media, thank God, he actually put out a statement, and this is what he said, part of it. He said, our hearts and minds are with the people being persecuted so unfairly relating to the January 6th protests concerning the rigged presidential election. Why that's capitalized, I'll never understand. In addition to everything else, it is proven conclusively that we are a two-tiered system of justice. In the end, however, justice will prevail, in all caps. You know, the wording here is just, it's remarkable. It's such projection. He does this all the time.
Well, you know, here's the irony, Tara. This is the same former president who signed an executive order after the protests subsequent to the death of George Floyd, making it mandatory for anybody who engaged in a protest or demonstration at a government facility being prosecuted and having a mandatory sentence.
Yeah, exactly. Like, this is the same guy. It's unbelievable. He's also, that whole thing, that situation, how they handled it last summer is another interesting conversation. Is I think that Trump, they could have done more to stop the protests and to be a bit more proactive and responsive to the righteous outrage of the American people over what happened to George Floyd, but they didn't want to.
Right.
They didn't want to. They gave a little bit, and then they were like, "No, let it burn," because they knew that that was a huge rallying issue for them politically, and it was really what breathed life back into the Trump election, the campaign, because it was, you know, it was on life support there, no pun intended, because of COVID. Mm-hmm. And that issue kind of gave people something to rally around. And so, yeah, he gets off on the chaos.
He certainly does.
And the fact that people are worshiping him, they're doing it in his name. He loves that, which leads me to another question about extremism and this whole, you know, we see that it's still a threat and it's rising, but is Trump's influence on this waning because he isn't out there all the time? He isn't the primary focus. He's not in office anymore. It seems to me like this is bigger than Trump even, which scares me also.
Well, Tara, you're right. It's bigger than Trump and it's bigger than the United States. What we're seeing now, and we've seen this for several years, is that these right-wing extremist movements have gone transnational. Mm-hmm. They've got links to Australia, Canada, Russia, South Africa. Mm-hmm. We're seeing that in their tactics and their messaging, that they're mirroring the tactics of Al-Qaeda and ISIS, who were quite successful in the past. For those who follow terrorism, the strategies and marketing of Al-Qaeda were demonstrably different than the improvements put in place by ISIS with regards to using social media, to using encrypted apps, to being overt in their recruiting strategies. We are seeing that now. What's really disturbing is since we've left Afghanistan, are the far-right extremists praised in encrypted chats online in those forums, praising the Taliban's, quote, victory, praising the Taliban's stance on being anti-LGBTQ. So to make matters even more difficult, these are the same organizations here in the right wing who are sharing bomb-making manuals and attacking manuals. Those are the same things our international adversaries do. So we have a larger problem than Trump. And to your point, the fact that he's not out there every day is not as important as it used to be. It's taking on a life of its own. And it's continuing to grow.
And I think it's something that the Republican Party is completely unprepared for. Because, you know, the McCarthys of the world and some of these people who are just going along because they in McConnell, who just want political power, they're underestimating this. They will turn on them quickly. They already really have. But I think that they are underestimating their ability to control it. And January 6th should have been that wake-up call, but clearly it's not. You mentioned international and Afghanistan and how it boggles the mind. I don't know if a lot of our viewers realize this, that there has been praise for the Taliban and what's going on there. That's the level that it's sunk into now. But also another rallying cry is our acceptance here of Afghan refugees who we promised, these are people who helped us, that we promised we would give them refuge here in the United States. And, you know, we can get into the failures of how that all unfolded at another time. But you've mentioned to me that you are seeing some disturbing patterns here with the Afghan refugee issue in the United States and this feeding this right-wing extremism that we're seeing emerge.
Absolutely. We're already hearing about the fact that people are coming here and they might bring COVID. They're coming here and they're unvetted and could be terrorists. I have to tell you that when refugees come in the United States, the vetting process is incredibly robust. As you know, the process of COVID testing for people who left the country has been incredibly robust. Mm-hmm. I'm really concerned that we have a return to some of the anti-immigrant, anti-refugee policies and practices that we had after 9/11. And many people don't remember that after 9/11, we had detentions where people were taken into custody in secrecy because it was classified. The government acknowledged almost 1,200 people being detained and arrested under the guise of being concerned about the terrorist threat they represented, when in fact, none of them were ever proven to have any connections to terrorism, and most of them were really detained for immigration issues. So I'm really concerned about that. And the fact that people are saying this, not knowing how we process refugees to the country, is just another excuse to push that anti-immigrant ideology, that otherism that really is the core of extremism in the United States.
That's right. I mean, you had people on Fox News, on Newsmax, on these right-wing media outlets showing pictures of when the evacuation was happening, of, you know, the C-17s full of Afghan refugees. saying, you know, you want these people to live next to you. You want these people in your community. And I just thought, first of all, they know nothing about the Afghan people, who are amazing and extremely family oriented and community centric. And, you know, I thought to myself, yeah, I'd much rather have any one of them in my community than next to these crazy Trump supporter, anti-vaxxers, anti-max, you know, mask wearing Oath Keeper Proud Boy loons. So, you know, they've got some nerve. Yeah, like, you know, and I live in Northern Virginia, which is bringing in, which is accepting a lot of Afghan refugees. And I think that's, you know, that's what America is supposed to do. You know, when we make a promise to people who've helped us in that fight for democracy, we should live up to our promises there. But
you're absolutely correct. You're making me think about a Twitter post that someone had one time that said, I'd much rather have a refugee next door than a racist.
Yeah, yes. Yes, that's and the sad part about that is we're thinking about that more and more every day in 2021. I feel like we're going backwards in so many ways that it's tough. But that's why, you know, we want to point this out. We want people to pay attention. I always believe that there are more of us than there are of them. They're just louder at times, and we need to match that level of passion and dedication and volume, because our cause, fighting to protect our democracy and doing the right thing, is much more powerful than the extremists. Oh, but if we give them agency and our complacency overtakes that, then they're going to win. We can't let them win. So
right.
We have another question from our audience here. This is you addressed this a little bit, but you said this is from Janet on YouTube. She's asking, do you think that the Capitol buildings in other states are in danger tomorrow? You hit on this a little bit, and I think that, you know, people are wondering, like, do we need to be worried in our own home states? What can we do? What do you think?
I think that's a great question, and I think she's right on target. I think that every one of the Capitol buildings needs to be concerned. Understand, this is a symbolic effort tomorrow. So it's not just about the United States Capitol, it's about the seat of government in each state. And so for those states that have open carry laws and California doesn't, and we can certainly talk about that with regards to why we don't, you and I have discussed that.
We have.
But for those states that have open carry laws, we saw what happened during stay-at-home orders from governors, to the point where we had two governors, Virginia and Michigan, that were the targets of kidnapping plots because they didn't want the government to do what they were doing, and their closest reach to that government was their state capital. So I do think that those state capital buildings are going to be on high alert, and for good reason they should be.
You know, we also have the addition now of the abortion issue that has come back into the political zeitgeist, which really hadn't been for many years. It was always there, but now it's back in the political fore because of what happened in Texas. And we already know that that adds on to some of this QAnon conspiracy theory stuff about, you know, sex trafficking and children. And it's crazy, like what happened at that tragedy in Florida with this guy thinking he was called from God and that some girl was being sex trafficked in her house and he killed the whole family and an infant. We're starting to see more and more incidences of this that are not necessarily organized, but they still feel drawn to this whole, it's almost like it's cultish. It's cultish in a lot of ways.
You're absolutely right. I mean, we've got the issue of abortion now coming to the fore, but let's remember, not 2 weeks ago, we had a guy with a truck bomb.
That's right.
Who threatened to blow himself up. We had an individual this past week who was a neo-Nazi arrested with a bayonet and a machete near the Democratic headquarters. So these people are not going away. They're engaging, and they are, regardless of what their ideological underpinning may be, there are a lot of hybrids out there. And by hybrids, I mean, you can have a person who's anti-government, anti-abortion, pro-right. They just check, it's like having a menu, and they check off what works for them, and they move forward. And it's extremely dangerous and concerning.
One of our other questions that came in, it's from a few people. They've consolidated, but basically people are wondering, so, all right, let's say there's only a couple hundred people that show up tomorrow. It's a ragtag group. It turns out to be not really a big deal. Do you think that then now that's going to be kind of downplayed in the right wing, saying like, oh, see, you know, this is nothing. It's just a honeypot and, you know, what, and ignore it and try to downplay it. And then people kind of become complacent again about it. And the next thing you know, boom, we get hit with something else like a January 6th.
I think that you're right. I think that they'll downplay it. They'll say it wasn't our organization. We never intended to be there in the first place. What I am really concerned about is first responder and law enforcement fatigue. The fact that this goalpost continues to get moved. And after a half dozen of these, will we respond 2 months, 3 months from now, the way we're responding tomorrow? Mm-hmm. And that's something, complacency is something that is always the Achilles heel for counterterrorism and homeland security efforts. And I'm hoping that every bit of intelligence we get is analyzed and determined whether or not it's actionable and taken seriously and then responded to accordingly for whatever event's coming up.
I know that, you know, speaking of counterintelligence, we just celebrated, I guess is kind of a loaded word, but we acknowledged the 20-year anniversary of 9/11 last weekend. And, you know, you have some anecdotes about that day. And I just wanted to give you an opportunity to talk a little bit about some of the things. Also, you used one example about the otherism, you know, this otherism sentiment that's coming up again. But what are some of the other counterintelligence differences that you're starting to see from 20 years ago to now?
Well, we got in a lot of trouble, Tara, 20 years ago because we didn't play well in a sandbox together. I mean, American culture is one of being very competitive and being number one. We had individuals that were here in San Diego that were on the radar screen with the CIA when they came over from Afghanistan. Operated in plain sight, didn't share the information with the FBI, and those two individuals are on a flight that flew into the Pentagon. And I have a colleague at Stanford, Amy Ziegert, who's a professor there, has written several books on it, but one book she wrote talks about 68 opportunities we had to identify these people, and we didn't do it. So that's a lesson learned. The other lesson learned is understanding that we do things called tabletop exercises in counterterrorism. Well, Richard Clark had a tabletop exercise years before 9/11 that had that exact scenario with a much smaller aircraft allegedly flying a plane full of explosives to the Capitol. They could not come up with the president's response that day in terms of policy. And on the day of the event, we still had not come up with the president's response. So we need to pay attention to these things and make adjustments. I'm really delighted that we've got joint terrorism task forces all over the country. And now you've got these agencies sitting in the same room. But then here we are almost 20 years later on January 6th talking about not sharing information. That's unacceptable now.
That's right.
It's unacceptable.
That's the idea of the wall of separation, right, which is what happened back in pre-9/11 that we heard that term and there are adjustments made so that we didn't have that again. It's the first thing I thought when I was reading those intel reports and how, you know, the FBI field office in Norfolk sent it to this one and that they didn't read it and it was on this one's desk. I was like, oh, my God, this is, you know, pre-9/11 all over again. How do we get here? And perhaps it's complacency. Perhaps we'll find out from the January 6th committee investigation that there were maybe some deliberate efforts to not allow our law enforcement and the Pentagon to do their jobs that day. And I'm sure that'll all come out. Final words. We're about 2 minutes to go. I know that I think it's important for people to know some of the work that you're doing. And I always like to highlight the Lewis Police Conduct Registry that is a passion project of yours. You see Lewis in the background. That looks like the Edmund Pettus Bridge, I think. Just talk briefly about what that is and any updates on how you're doing with it.
Thank you so much. So the Lewis Registry is named after John Lewis and the acronym stands for the Law Enforcement Work Inquiry System. We are taking public open source information on police officers that have been fired for misconduct, putting it all in our registry and making it available to people. There's a really agencies across the country are talking about accountability and transparency. We're happy to help with that. We believe that officers that get fired should not be officers anymore. There's a huge problem with that. So we're working with, happy to say we are working with activists and we're working with law enforcement agencies who are stepping up to help screen their personnel. I always say if progressives became police officers, we'd probably have a lot less problems. And so that's who we want to see joining law enforcement. And we're happy to help in that regard. So thank you for giving us a chance for a shout out.
Absolutely, because it's work that's necessary, and I think more and more people who are pro that really do back the blue need to see that it is there is a holistic approach to this, and nobody hates bad cops more than good cops. And people like yourself who have extensive experience in law enforcement getting involved, the community itself has to police itself more, and it just lends more credibility to it. So I think what you're doing is tremendous. And for people to see that, I will always continue to support it and highlight it where we can. Dr. Errol Southers, thank you so much for joining us on Lunch with Lincoln. We'll have you back soon, and keep up the great work, my friend.
Thank you, Tara. Always a pleasure. Thank you.
And before we